In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus Christ called his disciples the salt of the earth. In using this metaphor, Jesus did not mean that they were salt in and of themselves, any more than they were light in and of themselves. What they were to become would come about as a result of their relationship with him. That's the only thing that matters. Their relationship with him was the ultimate of ultimate importance. Jesus Christ had opened his personal instruction to them by teaching them the fundamental, essential characteristics required by those called to live under the terms of the new covenant. All of these characteristics, meekness, merciful, pure in heart, and so on, every one of these characteristics were perfectly reflected in the life of Jesus Christ. So the question then we need to ask ourselves, how are we fulfilling our basic responsibility to be the salt of the earth? How are we doing that? Let's examine Jesus Christ's instruction by turning to Matthew 5. In Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13. Matthew 5 and verse 13, Jesus Christ told his disciples, "You," he was speaking to them directly, "you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt becomes tasteless, with what shall it be salted? For it has strength for nothing any more but to be thrown out and trampled under by men." So you see here, Christ make a very important statement here. This is directed to his disciples. He said, if the salt becomes tasteless, another way, as it continues to say in this translation, if it has strength for nothing. So we see here then, tasteless salt has strength for nothing. It is good for nothing. But we're going to come back to that in a little bit. As Jesus Christ stated here, each individual's Christian responsibility to be the salt of the earth is not optional. Neither are any of the terms and conditions of the new covenant to which we have pledged to live under. We have been held accountable, brethren, for what we have promised to do. Failure to do so will bring on ourselves dire consequences, which again we'll cover later. Now, but let's note something very, very interesting here. The Greek word Jesus used here for earth, the Greek word is ge, is distinct from what we are quite familiar with as used for world, which is cosmos. From this then, we can conclude Christ in effect said his disciples are not the salt of this cosmos. Why? Well, salt, as we well know, preserves. It's a preservative. And this cosmos cannot be preserved. It is doomed for destruction. Now, the same Greek word for earth Christ used here, which is ge, is used in verse 5. Let's go up a few verses here. Verse 5, where Jesus says, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." The meek is going to inherit the earth. Now, brethren, Jesus Christ did not, the meek will not inherit a corrupted and defiled cosmos. So we must know the important difference here. The meek will not inherit a corrupt and defiled cosmos. But in order to get the full meaning of Jesus' statement to his disciples and how salt is actually a reference to himself, we need to examine the instruction given to ancient Israel in the law of the offerings. So let's go back to Leviticus chapter 2. And we're going to beginning in verse 1. We're going to look at the instruction given for the grain offerings. In Leviticus chapter 2 and verse 1. It says, when anyone brings a grain offering as an offering to the Lord, his offering shall be of fine flour. He shall pour oil on it and put frankincense on it and bring it to Aaron's sons, the priests. And he shall take from it a handful of fine flour and oil with all its frankincense, and the priest shall burn this as a memorial portion on the altar, a food offering with a pleasing aroma to the Lord. Now, we're not going to read the entire chapter. We're just going to take an overview of it. But the grain offering could be presented in one of three forms. The first one of which, as we just read in these two verses, is uncooked flour. Uncooked flour. This flour had to be crushed, it had to be ground, and sifted many times, because we note carefully what it says here, fine flour. Not just any flour, it had to be fine flour, which means it had to be sifted many times. You read some commentaries that say up to 13 times. But however many times it needed to be sifted, fine flour was designated. A portion of this, as we just read, a portion of this was offered on the altar with oil and frankincense. Now, the second form of the grain offering was unleavened cakes that we find in verse 4. And if you bring an offering of a meal or grain offering baked in the oven, it shall be unleavened cakes of, note again, of fine flour. So that's the second form of grain offering, unleavened cakes. And this unleavened cake could be prepared in one of three ways. Again, they had various ways that it could be done, but there's a commonality to all of these ways that we're going to come to in a minute. So in one of three ways, it could be you could knead the flour into unleavened cakes and bake in an oven, or baking the cakes in a pan of the or on a griddle, as we see, we can read in verse 5. It says, baking in a pan. Or baking the cakes in a frying pan. Now, these maybe sound like they're very the same thing, but they're not exactly the same, as we see in verse 7. If your oblation be a meat offering, baking in the frying pan. So there were various ways that this was done. Now, the third form of meal offering was green ears of corn, dried over fire and beaten to remove the grain. Drop down to verse 14 and we see this. And if you offer a grain offering of the first fruit unto the Lord, you shall offer for the meal offering of the first fruit green ears of corn, dried by fire, even corn beaten out of full ears. Now, what we find here is that all the work that was done in order to prepare grain for an offering, the crushing, the grounding, the sifting, the beating, the heat due to the fire, and so on, all of these various processes that this grain had to undergo pictured various aspects of the intense suffering Jesus Christ would endure in order to be that one offering God really desired. But let's notice that there were certain items that they were to be sure not to include in this offering. in Leviticus 2 and verse 11. Same chapter, verse 11. It says, no grain offering which you bring to the Lord shall be made with leaven. You shall burn no leaven nor any honey in any offering made by fire. So we find here a very important prohibition. Neither leaven nor honey could be used in the grain offering. Leaven and honey were prohibited because they cause fermentation, which in turn causes corruption. Nothing that causes corruption could be offered on the altar, that on the offerings that were all offered to God. Nothing. Now, in most contexts, we are quite familiar with the fact that leaven is a type of sin. We've just gone through that typology when during the days of unleavened bread, we are commanded, no leaven shall be eaten, remove the leaven, and so on and so forth. So we are quite familiar with leaven in this context, as it symbolizes sin. Honey, though, we're not quite familiar as leaven. Honey symbolizes natural affections, that which is according to nature. You can see why that could not be included in a minute. Let's read now verse 13. So the first thing we see, what was not to be offered. Now let's see what God commanded to be offered with these offerings. And every offering of your grain offering, you shall season with salt. You shall not allow the salt of the covenant of your God to be lacking from your grain offering. With all your offerings, you shall offer salt. What we see here then, the prohibitions regarding leaven and honey were followed by the command that every grain offering was to be salted with salt. Three times, you read in this one verse, three times this verse stresses that salt must be used not only on this offering which we are discussing, which is the grain offering, but on all the offering. As we read again the last part of verse 13, with all of your offerings you shall offer salt. The prohibition regarding leaven and honey here is set in contrast to what was offered before. Because to highlight the importance of adding salt to all the offerings, we see here a stark contrast. So there's a contrast that has been made, what is not to be offered and what is to be offered. God wants it to be not to be any mistake, any unknown. He wants to make sure that they know exactly what was an acceptable offering to him. So what was prohibited then, leaven and honey, and what was essential was salt. There must be salt, there must be no leaven or honey. But there was something else God instructed Moses that salt was to be added to. It wasn't just the offerings, all of the offerings. Let's go back to Exodus chapter 30 and verse 34. There was something else that God commanded to be offered. Exodus 30 and verse 34. These instructions were given to by Moses, these instructions were given to Moses by God, connected to the worship in the tabernacle. Verse 34, and the Lord said to Moses, take sweet spices, stacta, ononica, and galbanum, sweet spices with pure frankincense, of each shall be an equal part. Verse 35, and make an incense blended by the perfumer. And notice what it says in the last part of this verse. Seasoned, or the translation have salted, pure and holy. Seasoned with salt, pure and holy. This exclusive formula was given for the incense that was to be used only in the daily services performed by the high priest in the tabernacle. So we find here what was considered pure and holy because of what it symbolized could not be used until salt was added. Now, consider, can anything less than pure and holy be added to something that is considered by God to be pure and holy? Something less than pure and holy would be, in fact, a desecration of what God considers pure and holy. You cannot add anything less than pure and holy to what is already pure and holy. We remember, we're not going to go there, but we remember that even the fire that the incense was to be placed on had to be authorized by God. Nadab and Abihu, Aaron's sons, paid with their lives for failing to follow these regulations when they used strange fire to offer incense. So there's something important. There's something that's very important for us to take note regarding salt. And that holds the key to what it symbolizes. Salt did not form the offering. Because God gave various offerings. He says this, he did, whether it was a burnt offering, you take all these animals and so on, and whether it was a grain offering, sin offering, or whatever kind of offering it was. But salt did not form the offering per se. But it was never to be lacking in anything that was offered on the altar to God, including the incense. The offerings were not complete until salt was added. Now, there's a quality of salt that is very important, because salt prevents putrefaction, while leaven and honey produce it. Salt then was in meaning the very opposite of leaven that we saw before. God says, don't add this, but add this. So salt in its meaning was the very opposite of leaven. It was the symbol of that which opposes corruption. It was the symbol of incorruptibility. It symbolizes, therefore, the divine nature of Jesus Christ, which always was and is and always will be incorruptible. Now, salt was something that could not be readily destroyed by fire, or even time, or many or other means that is going back to ancient times. Even when the offerings went up in smoke, after being placed in the fire, the salt remained essentially unchanged. So that tells us something very important about the nature of Jesus Christ. And we find that in Hebrews 13 and verse 8. You don't have to turn there. Hebrews 13 and verse 8, where it states, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That is the nature of Jesus Christ. Now the salt, as we said earlier, the salt arrests corruption. It holds it at bay. It stops it from happening. It keeps off destruction, and it diffuses its purifying influence throughout all the particles with which it comes into contact. Salt was an essential addition to the offering because it reminds us not only that Christ was the sum of the offerings under the old covenant, but it teaches us, it's supposed to teach us a lesson that whatever we offer to God must be in and through Christ. We don't come to God on our own, so to speak. We come because Christ is in us. So whatever we offer to God, then must be in and through Christ. God will not accept our offering unless Christ is in it. God has redeemed us with the precious blood of his Son, as 1 Peter 1 and 19 brings out. So we are his property. We belong to God. He bought us with the precious blood of his own Son. Not to add salt to the offering amounts to denying the powerful influence of Christ in every facet of our lives. Salt was also emblematic of God's covenant relationship with Israel. Thus is it called the salt of the covenant of your God, as we read earlier in Leviticus chapter 2 and verse 13. Talks about the salt of the covenant, your God. This symbolized the enduring relationship between God and Israel, which was never to be broken. God also made a covenant of salt with the descendants of Aaron and David. Let's look over, we find that in Numbers 18. In Numbers 18, now we noticed something here. In Numbers 18, verse 1, just the first few words, "And the Lord said to Aaron." So God here is speaking directly to Aaron. It doesn't say God spoke to Moses and Aaron, which you'll find a lot of places. This is directed to Aaron. "And the Lord said to Aaron," dropping down in verse 8. You find the same thing in the first part of that verse. "And the Lord spake unto Aaron." And then he goes on to say what he spoke to him. But let's read, drop down and read verse 19. Verse 19. "All the heave offering of the holy things which the children of Israel offer to the Lord, I have given to you and your sons." Remember, God is speaking now directly to Aaron. Aaron was the high priest. His sons were the ones who were only the ones chosen to be able to minister directly before God. And note, "I have given it to you and your sons and daughters with you as an ordinance forever." The verse goes on, "It is a covenant of salt forever before the Lord with you and your descendants with you." This was so important that this is recorded that we could understand. Here we find that God made a pledge. God made a pledge to provide for the sustenance of the priest and their families. All the tribute that was offered to God became a gift from God to the priest and Levites. The covenant of salt between God and the Aaronic priesthood then emphasized the quality and permanence of that relationship. And we find in Ezekiel 43, we're not going to go there, but in Ezekiel 43, we find the Levites who are of the seed of Zadok will serve in the millennial temple. In 2 Chronicles 13, I'm going to find another covenant of salt here. 2 Chronicles 13. Now, in this chapter, we find that the state of hostilities between Judah and Israel erupted into open warfare during the days of Abijah. He invaded the northern kingdom with 400,000 men. In spite of his force, he was outnumbered 2-1. So here's Judah, King Judah, the nation of Judah, led by Abijah, going against Israel, the northern kingdom. 400,000 men. He's going against 800,000 men. That's an enormous force by any by any measure. Now, in spite of the fact that he was of number 2 to 1, he decided that he would go anyway. Now, let's notice what here, we're going to read one verse in verse 4. And what he did, the king of Judah, that is Abijah, he stood on Mount Zemarim and preached a sermon, in effect, to Jeroboam, the infamous Jeroboam. So he preached a sermon to Jeroboam and his troops. Let's notice just a little part of what he said to Jeroboam. Then Abijah stood on Mount Zemarim, which is in the mountain of Ephraim, and said, "Hear me, Jeroboam, and all Israel. Should you not know that the Lord God of Israel gave the dominion over Israel to David forever, to him and his sons by a covenant of salt?" Here we find Abijah reminding them that the true kingship lay with David's dynasty and not with Jeroboam. God had made a permanent bond, as Abijah brings out here, covenant of salt. God had made a permanent bond with David. And we can read again in Ezekiel 34, where we find that God stated that during the millennium, that David would once again be responsible for all Israel as their prince. That will be David's responsibility. The covenant of salt God made with David and the descendants of Levi will not be dissolved over time, nor will it fade away. It is an indissoluble alliance between friends. Now, it was God, of course, who made salt a requisite part of the sacrifices that we just read earlier. This was specifically given by God. Now, when the one who gave those regulations came in the flesh, he reinforced to his disciples the essential symbolic value of salt. Please turn with me to Mark. Mark chapter 9, verse 49. You're going to see that. Mark 9, verse 49. Mark 9 and verse 49. For everyone, it states here, for everyone shall be salted with fire. And note what Christ adds here, straight from Leviticus chapter 2. And every sacrifice shall be salted with salt. So we find here that Jesus Christ, at the end of this section to his disciples, he had been presenting very sobering lessons to his disciples on the need to take whatever actions necessary in their lives to remove that which causes sin. So let's just back up a few verses just to get the context. Again, Jesus is instructing his disciples the need to take very drastic action on certain things in their life. Let's look at verse 42. Mark 9, verse 42. Christ says, "But whoever shall cause one of the little ones who believe in me to offend." Now, the Greek word we've heard before, for offend is scandalizo. Scandalizo. It means to cause to sin, to put a stumbling block or impediment in the way, upon which another may trip. Now, I'm sure we've done this at least once as a child. I don't know, maybe you were a perfect child, you didn't do this, but you probably at one time or another want to play some fun with someone, and you would stick your foot out and as your friend or one of your siblings are walking by, you stick your foot out, and what happens, they wouldn't see it, they would fall down, they would fall over your foot. So if we have that picture in our minds, a stumbling block, causing someone to trip. Of course, the kind of tripping here that we are talking about is very serious. This is not a joke. This is not a childhood prank that we play on one another. This is serious stuff. Christ is telling his disciples. Continuing in verse 42, causes anyone of the little ones who believe in me to offend, it would be better for him, Christ continues, it would be better for him that a millstone be placed around his neck and he be cast into the sea. Verse 43, if your hand shall cause you to offend, and I think that should be more appropriately rendered sin, because we see the context. This is very serious because of the consequences Christ is going to bring up. It says, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed than to go with two hands into the unquenchable fire of Gehenna, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. And if your foot shall cause you to sin, Christ said, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life lame than to be cast with 2 feet into the unquenchable fire of Gehenna, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. And if your eye shall cause you to offend or cause you to sin, thrust it out. For it is better for you to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than to be cast with 2 eyes into the fire of Gehenna. Jesus Christ is showing here we have to make a choice. Everyone has to make a choice. The choice we will make, the choice we make will be death. If we insist on holding on to things that causes us to sin, no matter how precious they may be to us. Our hands may be precious. Our feet are precious. Our eyes. Christ, of course, is not speaking literally. He is speaking figuratively. Christ is saying, no matter how precious these things are to us, they must be gotten rid of. As Christ brings out in these verses here, the fire of Gehenna is unquenchable and symbolizes permanent destruction. Permanent destruction. Now, let's go back and read again in verse 49, where Christ says, for everyone shall be salted with fire. So we find here in this verse, Christ states without qualification that everyone of his disciples will be salted with fire. Now, what does this mean? This fire is not the same fire as the fire of Gehenna. The fire of Gehenna destroys. The purpose of this fire is for a different outcome. Christ is making a contrast here, using the same figure but to different effect. The fire of Gehenna destroys, but there's another fire because Christ desires another outcome. Now, as we saw earlier, it was the addition of the salt which made the sacrifice acceptable before God. It was the addition of the salt that makes the sacrifice acceptable before God, as Christ reiterates in the last part of this verse. Every sacrifice shall be salted with salt. Now, Paul reminds us in Romans chapter 12 and verse 1, Paul reminds Christians that they must offer themselves living sacrifices. Living sacrifices. What Christ is saying here, in effect, before a Christian life is acceptable to God, it must be treated with fire, just as every sacrifice was salted with salt. The fire of the salt that makes the life of a Christian acceptable to God, that is the fire that Christ is talking about. That is the outcome. So what, again, what type of outcome is the fire to produce? So just as salt is connected with purification, so is fire. Let's notice this in Malachi chapter 3. In Malachi chapter 3, verse 2. Malachi 3 and verse 2. But who can endure the day of his coming? And who can stand when he appears? Note what it says here. For he is like a refiner's fire and like launderer's soap. He will sit at the refiner and purify of silver. He will purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer an offering in righteousness. Now, this prophecy, as we well know, focuses on the soon coming return of Jesus Christ to the earth. Now, even though we find in this verse the tribe of Levi specifically mentioned, those who have been given the privilege of access to God, also can be known as the sons of Levi, those who have been given access to God must take note. Because the ones who will endure the day of Christ's coming are the ones taking heed to the rebuke and correction of Jesus Christ. Remember what Christ stated in Revelation 3 and verse 19. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Rebuke and chasten. We know that one of the two purifying agents mentioned here in verse 2 is fire. Fire burns out all the corrupt ingredients that are mixed with gold and silver. It is the fire which purifies the base metal. The alloy is separated and the metal is left pure. As for the Christian, fire then means everything which purifies life. The Apostle Peter brings this out in 1 Peter 1. 1 Peter 1 and verse 7. Peter writes, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it be tested by fire. No, this gold is tested by fire. May be found to praise, honor, and glory at the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, the word, Greek word that translated here, tested, is dokimazo. Dokimazo. Now, the intention of dokimazo is primarily to eliminate the dross and recover the valuable or genuine remains. So it's to remove the impurities. That is the purpose of this trial, of this testing by fire. A couple chapters over, 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 12, Peter writes again, Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. fiery trials are not the things we like to think about. They make us nervous. They make us uncomfortable. But Jesus Christ never indulged his disciples in anything to make them comfortable, to feel good about themselves. Jesus Christ never indulged his disciples in the fantasy of what the Christian life is all about, as we knew from the beginning, from the very beginning, before we started down this road. We were told, count the cost. It won't be easy. And yet, Peter says, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trials. When the fiery trials come about, we think it strange. So whether the fire is discipline or persecution, one must endure these things in order to be an acceptable sacrifice. The outcome is a life which has been purified according to God's standards. So as we go back again, back in Mark, towards the end of Mark, between Mark 9 and verse 42 to verse 49, we make a comparison, we make a contrast here. There is a fire that destroys. That is the fire of Gehenna. That is the fire that is unquenchable. It destroys. We don't want to be in that fire. But there's also a fire that preserves. There's a fire that preserves as it purifies this metal, this gold or silver, to remove all the impurities. So the alternative for everyone then is to choose. Choose between the destructive and the conserving influence. We have to choose. Christ's disciples then must submit to being salted with fire. The salting with fire is essentially the same as what Jesus Christ stated earlier in his teaching about the amputation of the hand and feet and the plucking out of the eyes. The plucking out of the eye which causes one to sin. That is the choice that we face. Either go through the painful process or the end result of the other process will be total destruction. Now earlier we saw in Matthew 5 and verse 13, that we began with Jesus Christ telling his disciples they were the salt of the earth. We saw earlier the dire warning Jesus gave his disciples in connection with their responsibility to be the salt of the earth. So let's take a look at the other accounts where this all-important reference to salt is made. There are a couple other references in the Gospels that is made. Now, again, we were in Mark chapter 9. Mark chapter 9 again. Let's notice in verse 50. Mark 9 and verse 50. Here Christ states, salt is good. But if the salt has lost its saltiness, how will you make it salty again? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. Let's turn over to Luke 14. Here we have a very similar statement. Luke 14 and verse 34. Christ states, salt is good, but if the salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Jesus Christ has given his disciples ears to hear. Now, Jesus Christ stated unequivocally, that salt is good, as we see in Luke 14 and verse 34. The word translated good, the Greek word, it means also means excellent. It means noble. But salt is good only if it retains its quality that makes it salt. Once salt ceases to perform its role, it is good for nothing. So the question then that we need to take a look at, how can this happen? How does salt loses its savor or loses its saltiness or taste or whatever your particular translation puts it? How does salt loses its savor? Salt loses its taste only if it reacts chemically with some other substance. That is, it becomes contaminated by outside influence. Now, the salt that was used in Christ's day was of the rock or fossil variety. And because of impurities and the occurrence of chemical changes, the outer layer, when exposed to the rain, the sun, and the air, can lose its saltiness. It still looked like salt, but the saltiness was gone. However, the salt that was close to the rock remained protected and retained its saltiness. So what are the implications for Christians as the salt of the earth? What should we be doing day in and day out to make sure that as salt of the earth, we do not lose our savor? The primary focus here then is that we must watch out. We must be on hyper alert for the things which will contaminate the new nature we have been given, the precious gift of the Holy Spirit. There are things that will cause contamination. We must resist then becoming spiritually contaminated. God is the one who has called us the salt of the earth. We have a responsibility to maintain this incredible blessing. We have to safeguard this blessing. We have to guard it to the utmost. Jesus Christ understood this very well. And he prayed about it to the Father, John 17, verse 15. Notice in John 17 and verse 15, Christ is praying just a few hours before he would be apprehended and subjected to the incredible, merciless beatings and abuse that any human being has ever seen. John 17 and verse 15, I do not pray that you should take them out of the world. The Greek word there is cosmos, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, cosmos, just as I am not of the world. And as we said before, Christians are not the salt of this cosmos. Or why would Christ be praying that they should be kept from the evil one? But they are not of the cosmos. Christ is stating this unequivocally. However, he says, he do not pray to take them out of the cosmos. Because there is a reason. Jesus Christ prayed to the Father that his disciples would be kept from the evil one. He went all out to make sure his disciples would be protected. So Christ fulfilled his responsibilities. Question is, the question all the disciples must face, are they themselves doing their utmost to keep out of the path of the evil one? Are they themselves doing their utmost to keep out of the path of the evil one. We all know we wouldn't ask God for protection from the evil one and then deliberately put ourselves into his path, thinking somehow that God will protect us. That is no different than what Jesus Christ faced when he was being tempted by the devil. Just notice quickly in Matthew 4 and verse 5. Because there's a principle here. Christ prayed that his disciples would be kept from the evil one. But Christ is not going to hold his disciples back if they are not vigilant in their responsibilities. In Matthew 4 and verse 5. And then the devil takes him to the holy city and set him on the wing of the temple. And he said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning you, and they shall bear you on their hands, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Jesus said unto him, that is the devil, "Again, it is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." We are in this world, but we are not supposed to be of this world, as Christ just stated. In other words, brethren, there must be no chemical reaction between us and this world. It is simply bad chemistry. Bad chemistry. This can amount to grieving or quenching God's spirit. Now, a chemical reaction is the transformation of one or more substance into another substance by the rearrangement of their fundamental building blocks, the atoms. So when you take a substance and you rearrange it, the basic building block, you have a chemical reaction. Let's take a simple example of fermentation. Fermentation is the chemical changes in organic substances produced by the action of enzymes. Simple example is, you take a fruit syrup, you add an enzyme such as yeast, it becomes alcoholic. It changes its basic structure. We cannot afford to react with this world and become someone Christ no longer recognizes because of that chemical reaction. The followers of Jesus Christ are permitted neither the luxury of compromise with a world that is under the sway of the devil, and we read that in 1 John 5:19, nor the safety of disengagement. We cannot be disengaged, go live out in a rock in a cave someplace because we don't want to be a part of this. We don't have that luxury. We don't have that choice, rather. We can't be needed to be disengaged or compromised with this world. The problem is we live in a world where the luxury of compromise is all too tempting and seemingly attractive. It is all around us. It's constantly bombarding us. Compromise, compromise. That is what we find. That is what we are constantly bombarded with. We are responsible to put up a resistance or risk being contaminated. Let's notice some instruction by the Apostle James in James chapter 1. James chapter 1, verse 26. James 1 and verse 26. If anyone thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their affliction, and to keep oneself unstained from the world. We find here then the Apostle James focuses our attention on how easy it is to deceive ourselves. It is so easy. We can think that we are a certain way, we are this or we are that, but the reality of what we really are shows up clearly, at least to God. God can see it. We can't hide from God. The reality of what we really is shows up in by the way that we live, which is our religion or service. Our religion is our way of life or our service. We may think our religion is acceptable before God, but as James brings out in this verse, if we are unable to hold in check, and that is what bridle means, to hold in check, self-control, if we are unable to hold in check what comes out of our mouths, then there is no worth to our religion. James here is very uncompromising. James uses several important terms that describe our religion, what is our way of life should be. Let's look at these terms in verse 27. The first one we're going to look at, religion that is pure. The word pure comes from the Greek katharos. And in its moral sense, it refers in this context to something that was once impure and polluted and has been cleansed. Something that was once impure and polluted and has been cleansed. It has to do with the purity of our lives. Remember again, we were cleansed by the precious blood. We were redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus Christ, which also cleanses us. So the purity of our religion depends on the motivation of our good works. Unless they are salted with salt, that is motivated by the selfless mind of Christ, they are worthless. So what is the motivation? What is the underlying motivation for the things that we do? Unless they come from a mind that is unselfish, the mind of Jesus Christ, unless that is the basis, James is saying here, no amount of good works is going to make them worth to God. They are worthless. The next term James uses here is undefiled. Now, undefiled means free from any impurity or flaw. This designation was used for the sacrifices that were offered on the altar. We can go back to Leviticus, the first five verses or so, and we find over and over again the term unblemished or undefiled or whatever is used. So undefiled means free from any impurity or flaw. This designation was also used for our high priest, the sum of what the offerings pictured. Let's note back here in Hebrews 7. Hebrews 7, verse 26, a couple of pages back. Hebrews 7, verse 26. For such a high priest was fitting for us, who is holy, harmless. Notice what it says here, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens. So Jesus Christ, our high priest, was undefiled. That is our example. That is the standard. When Jesus Christ walked the earth as a human being, no one could accuse him of remaining aloof from sinners, as if somehow they would contaminate him. He did not live the life of a recluse. After all, he was the only perfect human being who ever walked the earth. Why should he get involved in all these lowlifes? But that was not the approach of our Savior. Jesus Christ did not indulge in meaningless cleansing rituals when he came in contact with Gentiles. Neither did he turn aside from conflict with the tempter, nor did he avoid the company of the sinful. His arch critics accuse him of being the friend of publicans, of sinners. Can you imagine the derisive way they would speak about Jesus Christ? Friend of publicans and sinners. In spite of the fact he was constantly surrounded by a multitude of malignant influences, he remained absolutely untainted by their defilement. Again, that is what we just read. He was undefiled. In a world that was full of defilement, he remained undefiled. As, again, the Apostle Paul brings out in the last part of the verse, he was not only undefiled, separate from sinners. The other important term that James uses back in James 1, verse 27, the other important term we want to take a brief look at is unstained, as the last part of verse 27 states, to keep oneself unstained from the world. The word translated unstained means unblemished, and in a moral sense of pure or blameless. The example of Jesus Christ totally epitomizes a life that was spotless and unblemished. Let's go back to 1 Peter again. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 18. 1 Peter 1 and verse 18, Peter writes, "Knowing you were not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver or gold, from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers." What they were redeemed with? "But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot." That is what they were redeemed with. As the salt of the earth, then, the disciples of Jesus Christ must remain pure, undefiled, and unblemished. But James also brings out something else. Verse 27, there's a phrase here, visiting the fathers and widows in their affliction. Here we find helping the afflicted, and living a pure life go hand in hand. They go together. James links these just as Jesus Christ did in his instructions to his disciples. Let's notice back in Matthew 5 again. Matthew 5 and verse 7. All these qualities Jesus Christ brought out, they all link together. You don't take one out and say, well, let me pick this one. This one is good. Let me pick this one. All of these are linked together. In Matthew 5 and verse 7. Jesus stated, blessed are the merciful. That is what James brings out by showing mercy to the widows and the fatherless. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. A mark of Israel's obedience to God was to be a special concern for those who are helpless. God commanded the Israelites in Exodus 22 and verse 22, I'll just quote it here, "You shall not afflict any widow or fatherless child." God is very concerned about the way his people are to treat each other, especially those who are suffering and in need. Indeed, James brings out in James 4, a couple chapters over, James 4 and verse 17, James writes, "Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does it not, it is sin." The question we must confront ourselves with, how many times do we know and not do? Our hand must be open and our heart must be pure. You cannot have one without the other. You cannot think that you're going to do all these things, give an open hand, but yet ignore the purity that God demands. Both go hand in hand. Now, earlier we saw that the salt that was close to the rock remained protected and retained its saltiness. So what's the message for us? The message for us is that we must stay close to the rock. We must stay close to the rock as the salt of the earth if we want to remain uncontaminated and not lose our savor. Then we must get and stay close to the rock, which of course we know is Jesus Christ. Let's look at an example in ancient Israel in Exodus chapter 17. In Exodus chapter 17, we find here they're approaching, of course, Sinai, which they heard the voice of God. But here they had an encampment. Exodus 17 and verse 1. Then all the congregation of the children of Israel set out on their journey from the wilderness Sin, according to the commandment of the Lord. This is by God's instruction. Encamped in Rephidim. But there was no water for the people to drink. So again, Rephidim was the Israelites' last stop on the way from the Red Sea to Sinai. Now, the Israelites did not camp at Rephidim of their own choice. It was God that led them to a place where there was no water for them to drink. Now, in like manner, if God is leading us in the wilderness of this world, we need to be asking ourselves where the lessons are for us here. What are the lessons that we need to learn? There is no doubt that God wants us to take a close look at how he dealt with ancient Israel and how they reacted. Let's see how he dealt with ancient Israel here in verse 2. And the people did contend with Moses and said, "Give us water that we may drink." And Moses said unto them, "Why do you contend with me? Why do you tempt the Lord?" And the people thirsted there for water. And the people murmured against Moses and said, "Why is this that you have brought us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our cattle with thirst?" Pretty stout words against God's servant. So we find here in these verses, Israel reacted very predictably. They had a problem, they complained. Now, we ask ourselves, how predictably do we react when we run into these situations? But let's notice God's reaction. So Moses was upset. He cried to God in verse 4. Here's what God told him in verse 5. "An Eternal said unto Moses, Go on before the people, and take with you three of the elders, and your rod, wherewith you smote the river. Take in your hand and go. Behold, I will stand before you there upon the rock in Horeb, and there you shall smite the rock, and there water come out of it, that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel." Now, even though Moses was upset, God was merciful. God chose the physical rock as a supernatural source of life-giving water for ancient Israel. Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians 10:4 that Christ was that spiritual rock from which they drank. For ancient Israel to stay alive, they had to continually drink water from the physical rock. They had to stay close to the rock. And there was only one rock. In like manner, God's spiritual nation must, to stay alive, spiritually alive, they must stay close to the rock and drink of the living waters. There is no way, absolutely no way, we will remain alive if we wander away from the rock. That rock will not follow us. Jesus Christ will not come running after us, begging us to get close to him. We have already received the invitation. Now it's up to us. We must take action. The door has already been opened. We must take action. But there is a mindset that God has also given us an example of one who was called to be the salt of the earth. Psalm 63. We know this is, of course, the prophet David. Psalm 63 in verse 1, where David says, "O God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water." Those whom God is working with in this day of salvation have been given the opportunity to see God early. That is before the vast throng of humanity. Brethren, how much value do we place on this incredible privilege? This is unlike anything on the face of this earth. How much value do we place that we have been given the opportunity to see God early? The question is, are we allowing ourselves to have more and more exposure to the influence of this cosmos? This is a guarantee that as salt, we will lose our savor. David understood that there was only one rock from which living waters flowed. He knew that there was only one source that could satisfy his thirst. How about us? Notice what David said in verse 8. "My soul follows hard after you. Your right hand uphold me." The word translated follows hard, or following hard, follow hard, means to cling to cleave to keep close to. If you look at the translation as the Hebrew is just written out, it says, "It has stuck my soul after you." Doesn't sound polished and English, but I think we get the message. It has stuck my soul after you. Ancient Israel was instructed many times to cleave to God in affection and loyalty. Many times, let's look at several examples here. Deuteronomy 10 and verse 20. Deuteronomy 10 and verse 20. A Moses is admonishing them, you shall fear the Lord your God, you shall serve him. And note what he says here, to him you shall hold fast, or you shall cleave and swear by his name. Our oath, so to speak, is the commitment we made to God and Christ to live under the terms of the new covenant. God is holding us accountable. Over the next chapter, Deuteronomy 11 and verse 22. Deuteronomy 11 and verse 22. For if you carefully keep all these commandments which I command you to do, to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and note again, to hold fast to him, or to cleave unto him, to cling to him. There's absolutely no way we can hold fast to Christ if we are not carefully keeping all his commandments. This calls for no less than having and using his mind. It is not what we can muster on our own strength. Next couple of chapters over, Deuteronomy 13, verse 4, states, you shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him. Deuteronomy 13, verse 4. And fear him, and keep his commandments, and obey his voice. And note what it says here again, you shall serve him and hold fast to him, or cleave unto him. Have we allowed our ears to become dulled when we are reminded that unless we walk in Christ's steps, we were called to walk in Christ's steps, and unless we are fulfilling that responsibility, we won't be getting to the right destination? Ancient Israel refused to walk after the Lord their God. Moses says here, you shall walk after the Lord your God. Ancient Israel refused to walk after the Lord their God. Unless those of spiritual Israel are faithfully walking after Jesus Christ, those individuals will lose their salt and will become useless. From the perspective then of Jesus Christ as the one great sacrifice, the Apostle Paul echoed the dire warning Christ gave his disciples about what happens to when salt has become tasteless. Let's notice this in Hebrews 10, verse 26. Hebrews 10, verse 26. Paul writes, for if we willfully go on sinning, after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there is no longer any sacrifice for sins, but a terrifying expectation of inevitable judgment and a fierce fire which will devour the adversaries of God. Consider this, Paul reminds us. Anyone who rejects the law of Moses dies without mercy and under the testimony of two or three witnesses. Then here's the dire warning. Here's the warning for us. How much worse, he goes on, how much worse punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled on the foot the Son of God and has regarded the blood of the covenant with which he was sacrificed as an unholy thing and has scorned, or other translation says, and has insulted the Spirit of grace. So we've seen the symbolism, brethren, of the inestimable value of salt, as God commanded it to be included in every sacrifice. And the reality is, unless Christ is in us, we cannot be and never will be the salt of the earth. But we have a grave responsibility to safeguard that precious gift by using it. And let's go back and read again what Jesus said in Mark 9 and verse 50. Salt is good, it is excellent, it is noble. But if the salt has lost its savor, how will you make it salty again? But Jesus encourages his disciples. He says to us, to all of us, have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another.